Hello. This is our talk, Code Switching versus Boring, the case of hesitation markers in Evenki, by Maria Egorova, Elena Rudnitskaya, and Elena Klyachko. I will start with telling you about the Evenki language itself. Evenki is the most widespread Tungusic language spoken in Russia and China over a vast territory. This talk will focus on the dialects of Russian. The Evenki language is spoken over a vast territory and has a lot of dialects and has overcome a huge amount of language contact. It has complex morphology, which also influences the way discourse markers are used. Here is a map drawn in the middle of the 20th century, reflecting the distribution of dialect groups. And you can see that there are Western dialects, this northern set and southern set, and eastern dialects. Nowadays, Evenki mostly contacts with Russian, which is a Slavic language and the state language of Russia, and Sakha or Yakut, which is a Turkic language and the state language of the Republic of Sakha as a part of Russia. Actually, the contact with Sakha was quite longitudinal. According to the sociolinguistic surveys we have made, in some families there were bilingual speakers already in the 19th century, or perhaps earlier. In this study, we will refer to Evenki as L1, Russian as L2, and Sakha as L3. But the choice of numbers like L2 and L3 actually does not reflect the order of importance of these languages, Russian and Sakha. Nowadays, almost all speakers of Evenki are bilingual or trilingual, and the Evenki language is actually endangered. Less than 5% of native Evenki actually speak it, according to the census data. It is taught at school, but quite sporadically and inconsistently, and it has almost no mass media. When analyzing discourse markers, it is very important to have oral text corpora, because discourse markers are often omitted in published texts. And so it is a great luck that we have two corpora of Evenki. One has been collected by Olga Kazakevich and her colleagues. Here it is. Another one has been collected in the Institute of Anthropology and Ethnography. These corpora comprise mostly Western dialects, like this and this. However, they also have some texts in Eastern dialects. Mostly, the texts are narratives, like life stories and folklore texts. And it is also good that we have data on sociolinguistic situation, because we have sociolinguistic questionnaires collected from the speakers, and so we can look at their sociolinguistic biographies.
And now we will consider the Evenki hesitation markers. And we will start with the hesitation markers or placeholders of Tungusic origin, because the placeholders of Tungusic origin usually do mirror the morphological structure of the phrase they are supposed to substitute. And the first item here is ungun, a placeholder of an unclear origin, but obviously Tungusic. It is used as a placeholder, and it only can substitute proper nouns, so it does take a nominal morphology when used in a sentence, like in the example one, бои унгунме дэвид па панде. That means, fellow, do you know what's his name, David? Here the speaker forgot the word David, the noun David, and he used ungun with the accusative suffix man. Un bun man. The next item is ungi, that can be used as a placeholder and as an interjection. And these root can take both nominal and verbal morphology because it can substitute both nominal and verbal target words. Like in the example two, where the root angi is used twice, umno angiwa bagdakuwa angim, that means I once did, how do I call it? What's its name? A wild reindeer. And for the first time, the root angi is provided with the nominal morphology with the suffix wa, and it substitutes the word for the wild reindeer, bagdaku, bagdakuwa, that the speaker forgot for a moment. And for the first time, it is used with the verbal morphology, angim, and here the speaker probably tried to avoid the verb killed that seemed inappropriate in this kind of discourse. The third item is iakum, that originates from the interrogative pronoun what. Iakum is used as an interrogative pronoun as well, and its cognates are used in other Tungusic languages. Iakum is used as an interjection and as a placeholder, and it also can substitute both nominal phrases and verbal phrases. So in the example three, we find it with the verbal morphology. Elki mine era ijivkone. She didn't let me do that thing, play. And we see here that era does mirror the morphological structure of the verbal phrase only partially, because we find here this negative participle suffix ra, but we don't find any positive morpheme on the placeholder. Perhaps because at this stage of planning, the speaker didn't even know that he or she will choose the causative form. And now we will turn to the last Tungusic placeholder, er, that is indeclinable. It can be used as an interjection. And here in the example four, we find it at the beginning of the sentence. Erke urke we angaldinde. Well, it will start opening the door. This marker er originates from the demonstrative pronoun this. And usually is used when the speaker is uncertain about the whole sentence. And this marker allows a speaker to take his or her time, like in the example four. Here the marker R is close to the Russian loan word eta that we will consider later. But at first, I want to show you the map. Here we can find three declinable placeholders, ONLA, UNLA, and WHAT items in different Tungusic languages. And from here we can see that Tungusic lects do not show any clear preference to any of these placeholders. And now we will turn to the borrowed items, and we will start with the Russian eto. In Russian, the placeholder eto can be either declinable, eto, eta, etat, or indeclinable, and Evenki borrowed it in its indeclinable form, like in the sentence 5. Би тоже, би хавальчав, сав, это кал, это колхозту хавалили. Me too, I worked, I started to work well at a collective farm. Here the speaker tried to remember the word kolkhoz, that is also a Russian loan word. And at first she obviously tried to say savkhoz, savkhoz too. Savkhoz is another word for collective form, slightly different. But then she hesitated. She said eta twice, and then she ended up with kolkhoz too. And here we find many loan words like kolkhoz and savkhoz and Russian тоже, too. And finally, we turn to the саха material. So the last example is an example from саха, буала, that we can find in the example 6. Ади, ади, була, ну, окин, дегин, наверно, вичан, уже туге була. Here we also find many loan words, like Russian particle ну, well, and Russian наверно, maybe. And for the first time, we find this placeholder була in the middle of the sentence, where it is used as a placeholder. And at the end of the sentence, we find it again, probably with an approximative semantics here. How much? Well, it was perhaps 4 o'clock already in winter, where the speaker probably tries to underline this perhaps meaning here.
So the question is, when to choose L1 and when to choose L2? It turned out that most speakers use native placeholders, even semi speakers. It also turned out that fluent speakers actually use borrowed placeholders as well as native placeholders in similar contexts. Sometimes borrowed placeholders are accompanied with code switching into Russian. Generally, it seems that whether to choose L1 and L2 is characteristic of a person rather than their fluency. And it is also remarkable that borrowed placeholders are more often used by proficient speakers who have had little practice in Evenki recently. So here are some examples. This is a speaker who is middle-aged. She lives in a village where there are very few Evenki speakers, and she's bilingual in Evenki and Russian. However, she does not really use Evenki much in her everyday life. Her father was a good narrator of folklore, and she also remembers folklore, and her texts are quite fluent, but they have a lot of code mixing, and so she prefers the Russian placeholder F. Here is another speaker who comes from... Here is another speaker who also prefers the Russian placeholder. He's quite elderly. He's bilingual in Evenki and Russian. However, he now lives in a region where there are no Evenki speakers. Perhaps the only Evenki speaker is his sister. He also remembers folklore, and his texts are quite fluent, but they have a lot of code mixing. Here is another example. It is a woman who is younger than those speakers. She lives in a village where there are Evenki speakers, and she nowadays mostly speaks Russian with her family. However, there are relatives who she speaks Evenki with. She is bilingual in Evenki and Russian. Her texts are quite fluent, but have a lot of code mixing and code switching, and she uses the Evenki placeholders extensively when she does not recall the Evenki word. If we refer to typological studies, we can see that discourse particles and conjunctions are borrowed quite often, and it is confirmed by our study. However, we have not yet evaluated the number of borrowings in general, and we have not evaluated the number of borrowings from L3, that is Saha. So to conclude, it seems that preferring borrowed placeholders over native ones indicates not the fluency of a speaker, but rather their exposure to communication in Evenki. Passive speakers who are more exposed to the Evenki speech have difficulties when producing speech, but then they will use the Evenki placeholders. So our further plans are to annotate more data from the Far East, which will allow us to analyze cases of L1, L2, and L3 hesitating markers in the Far East. We're also going to count the statistics of borrowing from L2 and L3 into L1. Thank you very much for your attention, and we're looking forward to hearing your questions. Goodbye.
Cool.